In this module, we will continue exploring EMS system communications and principles of communicating with the other healthcare professionals. Once completed with this module, you should be able to explain factors related to effective communications with medical control, explain the importance of proper communication with receiving facilities, describe principles of communication system maintenance, and identify current and emerging technology used to collect and exchange patient and scene information electronically. To begin our discussion, it is important to recognize that it can be a rarity for an EMS agency to transport patients to only a single location. In those cases, the EMS crews have it a little easier in that their medical control is typically associated with or housed within that single transport destination. For the remainder of EMS agencies, however, there is often no guarantee that you will be transporting to the same facility out of which you receive your medical control. Paramedics must keep this distinction in mind as they are required to follow their offline and online protocols as approved or provided by their medical control. If transporting to a destination that wants the EMS crew to perform a skill or intervention or administer a medication or a dosage that is not approved within their protocols or that requires the approval of medical control, that crew will need to either refuse to perform the skill or intervention or refuse to administer the medication, or they will have to discontinue the communication with the receiving facility, contact their medical control for further guidance and possibly orders to perform a skill or intervention or administer a medication at a particular dosage, and then recontact the destination facility to provide an update. Again, remember that medical control does not mean the same thing as receiving destination within the context of obtaining or validating orders and online protocols. With that in mind, paramedics function predominantly through the use of offline protocols that define skills and interventions to be performed or medications to be administered when faced with particular patient presentations. Because every patient contact is unique and not all patients present with signs, symptoms, and ailments that lend themselves to cookie-cutter medicine, where a provider sees A, does B, and expects C to happen, paramedics must have the ability to contact online medical control when necessary for consultation and to obtain orders to perform skills or interventions or to administer certain medications at particular dosages. Because EMS can be called upon at any time, day or night, to respond to a call for service, the availability of this medical control must be 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. When communicating with medical control, it is of critical importance that the paramedic be clear, concise, and accurate while painting a picture for the medical control physician. Unless some type of video chat service is utilized whereby the physician can physically see the patient's presentation, the medical control physician must rely upon the paramedic to be his or her eyes, so to speak. That medical control physician needs to be made aware of the patient's signs and symptoms, how the patient is presenting, any special circumstances that could have an impact on the care provided, and what type of guidance, permissions, or orders the paramedic is seeking. If the medical control physician has questions, the paramedic should be able to answer them or obtain the answers relatively quickly. If the paramedic did a good job of describing the patient's presentation and needs, the medical control physician may not have any questions. If the medical control physician provides a paramedic with an order to perform a skill or intervention or to administer a medication at a particular dose using a particular route, the paramedic needs to repeat that order to the medical control physician word for word to ensure the paramedic's understanding of the order is correct. Any orders that are unclear or appear to be inappropriate should be questioned by the paramedic or clarified by the medical control physician. The paramedic should also ensure the order is properly documented within the patient care report, which means including the name of the medical control physician who is providing the order. At some point during your transport of a patient, you will need to contact the transport destination hospital to let them know you will be arriving with the patient. This will give the facility time to prepare for the patient, which can be of critical importance if your patient needs rapid, specialized interventions. If your transport destination and medical control facility are one and the same, it may not be necessary to repeat everything that you told the medical control physician if you made contact with him or her earlier on the call. Regardless, there are several pieces of information that the EMS crew should share with the receiving facility when transporting a patient to them. Remember that, until you contact the receiving facility, they probably have no idea that a patient is on his or her way to them. Therefore, your call puts them on notice that you are en route with a patient. If the hospital is on diversion, this is a good time for them to tell you that. Otherwise, there may be an EMTALA obligation that arises and precludes them from turning you away later. EMTALA is discussed in another module dealing with the legalities and ethics associated with patient rights and advocacy. Assuming the hospital is accepting patients, your communication with them will help the hospital prepare for the patient's arrival. Depending upon the type of patient you are transporting, the hospital may begin preparations for coronary care, stroke intervention, or maybe even a direct admit into a maternity ward. Remember, EMS is part of the larger healthcare system, and this communication is vital in supporting continuity of care for our patients. Integrating within that system during a patient transport begins with that phone call or radio transmission to the receiving facility. When contacting the receiving facility, there are several key pieces of information that should be provided. These include your unit number, who you are transporting, the gender and age of the patient's chief complaint, pertinent history, pertinent assessment findings, including vital signs, interventions performed, including medications administered, how the patient responded to those interventions, the patient's current status, including his or her mental status, and your estimated time of arrival. If you have 12-lead telemetry and the call could be cardiac in nature, be sure to transmit that data to the receiving hospital. If the hospital has questions, be sure to answer them. If the hospital would like to see you perform additional interventions or administer medications, do so if they fall within your offline protocols. Otherwise, contact your online medical control for additional guidance. Upon arrival at the receiving facility, you will need to transfer care of the patient to hospital staff, which includes an in-person transfer of care report to the receiving staff. While you may have already provided considerable details to the receiving facility in your previous radio or telephone report, there is no guarantee that the person to whom you are transferring the patient was the one who took your radio or telephone report. Therefore, it may be worthwhile to ask the healthcare provider if he or she was the one who took the radio or telephone report. If so, then ask if he or she has any questions or needs any additional information. If not, then you should provide the healthcare provider with much of the same information you shared in your radio or telephone report. Another thing to keep in mind is that not everyone you speak with at the receiving facility is a nurse, physician, or a healthcare provider. Some hospitals may utilize clerical intake, an ED technician, or other staff to collect information from incoming EMS units. Many hospitals also provide learning opportunities for students who may be participating in the patient intake process. When transferring care of the patient at the receiving facility, it is important to ensure the person to whom you are transferring care is indeed a healthcare provider with that facility who is authorized to assume patient care. At the least, that person should be a licensed healthcare provider with knowledge and training that meets or exceeds that associated with your paramedic licensure. In many cases, this person should or would be a registered nurse or maybe even the ED physician. As always, ensure your communications are clear, pertinent, concise, and professional. If anything in the patient's condition has changed since you provided your radio or telephone report, be sure to update the receiving staff. Ask the receiving staff if they have questions about any of the information you shared or if they need anything else from you. Remember that the purpose of this handoff conversation is to ensure the continuity of care for the patient. We even discussed in a previous module on patient safety that the patient handoff process is considered to be one of 7 high-risk EMS activities that lead to bad patient outcomes. Failing to convey important clinical findings and information can lead to subsequent errors in patient care. Therefore, it is incumbent upon you to ensure the receiving facility staff has all the information they need to provide appropriate, high-quality care to the patient. If you have information that may have an impact on the patient's care, either during or after the transfer of the patient to the receiving facility, you want to share that information with the receiving staff. To that end, some resources suggest that EMS providers use what is known as the SPAR technique when conveying patient information to other healthcare providers. Using a consistent, standardized technique for relaying patient information to other healthcare providers can help ensure you do not forget anything important. The S in SPAR stands for situation. Explain the current patient situation to the receiving person, including any issues that may apply or arose during your time with the patient. B is for background. This is essentially where you share the patient's current pertinent history. What prompted the ambulance response, and why is the patient now with you at the hospital? This is the background information you should share. The A in SPAR is for assessment. Tell the receiving healthcare provider about the assessment you performed and, more specifically, your findings. What was worrisome? Were there pertinent negatives? How did the patient respond to any interventions you performed? What do you believe is going on? Lastly, is your recommendation. Is there anything you believe should be done or performed next now that the patient is at the hospital? Obviously, the emergency room physician and their standing protocols will typically dictate what happens next, but that still does not mean you cannot provide suggestions or recommendations given your time with the patient. Keep in mind that other non-healthcare providers may be in the room, which could possibly include friends or family members of the patient. The patient can probably hear you as well. Provide facts and observations without bias or personal opinion. Do not disparage or defame the patient. Again, always be professional and courteous. Additionally, if you are transferring any of the patient's personal effects along with the patient, be sure to let the receiving staff know that as well, and be sure to document it within your patient care report. While documentation was discussed in a previous module, this is another area where documentation can be important, as some systems may have protocols that require some type of documentation be delivered to the ED staff along with the patient. Within Wisconsin, State Law DHS 110.34 sub 7 requires EMS providers to submit a written report to the receiving hospital upon delivering a patient. This report need not be a full patient care report, but it must be some type of document that has previously been approved by the state's Department of Health Services and the receiving hospital. Lastly, at some point you will leave the hospital to return to the station or another location. If there is a protocol to be followed at a specific hospital before leaving, which may include the replenishment of supplies or medications, or performing decontamination procedures, be sure to follow them. Be sure to let appropriate hospital staff know that you are leaving and, as a result, will no longer be available on site to answer any additional questions about the patient you just transported to them. In a previous module, we discussed the components of an EMS communication system and how EMS units and providers commonly interface with dispatch. Now that we also elaborated upon EMS interactions with other healthcare providers, we need to revisit some additional communication system topics that can impact effective communications between EMS agencies and providers and other entities such as dispatch and hospital staff. The first such topic is the maintenance of your communication system. Unfortunately, technology is not infallible. Equipment and electronics can fail, sometimes without warning. To ensure your radio system is functioning appropriately, routine radio checks should be conducted with your base stations, mobile radios, and handheld portable radios. If your portable radios have a feature that allows you to check the status of the battery, be sure to utilize it. Given that EMS providers may spend considerable time away from a base station or vehicle-mounted mobile radio, ensuring your portable radio batteries are healthy and can maintain a decent charge over time is important. If your radios utilize multiple channels, be sure to test those as well. There may even be some value in testing mobile and portable radios in different areas within your response territory to identify any dead spots that may exist. Also work with other third parties with whom you communicate via radio, such as hospitals, air medical services, and other public service agencies, to ensure your communications with them are going through as expected. Depending upon the complexity of your radio system, you may even have a person or department that is responsible for the maintenance and upkeep of your radios and the radio system. As a paramedic, this system oversight will probably not be one of your regular job duties. Regardless, your participation in whatever radio check process is used by your agency is critical in helping ensure the system works as it should. Another important communication consideration for an EMS agency is what to do if your communication system experiences a failure. If you are on scene and the battery dies on your radio, or you are in a dead spot and cannot receive a signal, what is your backup plan? How will you communicate with dispatch, your medical director, or a receiving hospital? Some agencies maintain a separate simple VHF or UHF radio system as a backup to more complicated digital trunking systems. Cell phones are becoming more popular as backup devices if there is a radio issue. Other internet access devices may also be alternatives, such as a computer or tablet device running specialized software. Some dispatch centers even have the ability to send and receive SMS text messages. In the event of a large-scale disaster, some communications infrastructure may be lost or adequate bandwidth may not be available because too many members of the public are trying to communicate with friends, family, and others. Many cell phone companies have mobile communications equipment that can be transported to an on-site location to provide cellular communication capabilities where they previously did not exist or have been interrupted. In a previous module, we mentioned the FirstNet system, which will actually prioritize emergency service agency traffic and preempt other users of the system to accommodate emergency agency communications. Again, in the role of a paramedic, it is unlikely that you will need to develop these contingency plans to address communication system issues. Still, you do need to know what plans your agency has in place and how to acquire or utilize those alternative resources when necessary. Beyond radio systems, EMS agencies have more communication options available now than they ever did before. Cell phones and wireless communications have been around for years, but now our devices do much more than just make phone calls. Fast and reliable wireless transmission of data now makes it easy to share telemetry from various medical devices, such as a 12-lead EKG, and we now have reached the point with our technology that mobile video calling and conferencing is a reliable means of communication. Community EMS agencies can use tablet devices to speak face-to-face with available physicians, and those physicians can now see and even communicate with their patients remotely using such technology. Some wearable devices, such as the Apple Watch, can even have cellular connectivity and be used for receiving phone calls. Similarly, the latest iteration of the Apple Watch, as of the time this presentation was developed, can even be used to capture an EKG of the person wearing it or to make a 911 call. These smartphones and devices are often used to carry emergency contact and medical information as well. The iPhone even allows a person to indicate their consent to be an organ donor. As the technology continues to evolve, additional features are added, and more people become connected at even greater levels, communication options for both the public we serve as well as EMS agencies in general will continue to expand. Paramedics need to be familiar with these communication options as they are adopted for use by EMS agencies, other healthcare organizations, and the public we serve. While your agency's policies, procedures, and protocols will typically govern most of your radio and telephone communications with medical control and other agencies, along with testing and maintenance requirements for those systems, this module covered some generalities that are routinely applied across different EMS agencies. Given your completion of this module, you should now be able to explain factors related to effective communications with medical control. Explain the importance of proper communication with receiving facilities, describe principles of communication system maintenance, and identify current and emerging technology used to collect and exchange patient and scene information electronically. This presentation was prepared by Waukesha County Technical College in Pewaukee, Wisconsin, and is distributed with an attribution, non-commercial, share-alike 4.0 International Creative Commons license. Copyright 2019 Waukesha County Technical College. For information on WCTC's numerous fire and EMS educational offerings, please visit us online at wctc.edu.